edition of Gold Cup Today. I'm Samantha Yarock for MLSsoccer.com, and let's jump right into last night's action. All right, well, Panama beat Martinique 1-0 last night, followed by Mexico beating Canada 2-0. We just took a look back at those highlights. Andrew, what was your biggest takeaway from these games?
Well, my biggest takeaway centers around the referees. We'll look back to that first game against Martinique and Panama. Three instances in this match in which Martinique thought they should have got a call. The first coming in the first half on a handball in the box. That one was a bit iffy, as was the second one in which a man was pulled down at the edge of the area in the second half. But the third, Steve Guston clearly impeded in the area. That should have been a PK call. Martinique should have had an opportunity to go up in this game. As it stood, they went down a man, and then in the 85th minute, wouldn't you know it, a PK call of their own, taking down a man in the box. That one was clear. Gabriel Torres finishes that one off. Martinique has reason to be upset. Their coach actually saying, through two games, he thinks there are five instances in which they didn't get a call.
Hey, Andrew, speaking of penalty kicks, you haven't even touched on the potentially bogus one in that Mexico-Canada match.
Yeah, potentially is one word for it. I would say certainly. Marco Fabian, early in the second half, a through ball into the center of the Canada area. He gets on the end of it. David Edgar sticks out a foot to challenge. It doesn't appear there is any contact there, however, and Fabian goes down a little bit late. That's an unfortunate call for Canada, but look, it was the second goal, the insurance goal in this game. They didn't create a ton of chances. Mexico didn't either, but they finished off the two good ones that they had. In this instance, they had to get that win. They got it, any means necessary for Mexico at this point.
Yeah, Mexico needed this win, as you're saying, however they could get it. And does this now take any of the pressure off of Chepo?
Maybe a smidgen, perhaps, but you saw in that post-game press conference, the Mexican press are not giving him a break unless he gets to the final. There is a goal in this, and it is not to beat a low-hanging side like Canada in the Gold Cup. You've got to get in the knockout stages, you've got to make it to the final, and realistically, they expect victory. So I think a little bit of the pressure is taken off, but now the expectations jump up once again. They need to blow out Martinique in this final. They need to look good, they need to attack, and that's something we haven't seen so far.
Well, after these two nights of games for Group A, Canada is the only team with 0 points. Do they even have a chance of getting out of this group stage?
Yeah, it's going to be really tough for Canada. No points after two matches, and then they face Panama. You know Panama is going to be motivated in this one. Positioning, very important going into those quarterfinal stages. They don't want to get matched up with someone early on that can knock them out, so I think Canada's out of this. You look at it, they don't have Will Johnson, no Russell Tybert, he went home sick. They just don't have the attacking options to get it done. And if they have to have any chance, they've got to beat Panama and they've got to blow them out for goal differential. I don't think it happens for this Canada side.
Well, Andrew, tonight kicks off Group B's second night of games. What are you looking for? What's the big story here?
Well, Simon mentioned it yesterday. Honduras, El Salvador, probably the match of the group stage, but it's the other match I think has a little bit more importance when you think about the actual quarterfinals. Trinidad and Tobago and Haiti. Haiti has no points. Trinidad won along with El Salvador. Whoever gets points, hopefully a win in this one, has a chance of being one of those third place teams, and that's what really matters going forward.
Well, you can catch tonight's Group B games on Fox Soccer, Trinidad and Tobago versus Haiti kicking off at 7 p.m., followed by El Salvador versus Honduras at 9:30 p.m. Well, let's move on to our U.S. Men's National Team Spotlight. Andrew, are you ready?
I certainly am. I'm sure the viewers are as well.
Well, the U.S. faced Cuba on Saturday, July 13th at Rio Tinto Stadium. Let's hear from Nick Raimondo about playing at home.
I'm excited to get back to Salt Lake City. We had a little bit of a taste of it last month. I think the fans are raring to go again. It's something special to have two games there. and this time hopefully to be on the pitch, to be in front of my fans and hopefully a sold-out crowd. So I'm excited. I know Beckerman's excited, and the team's raring to go.
Well, we just heard from Nick, and as you can tell, he's excited to be playing in front of this energetic home crowd. Does Cuba even stand a chance?
I think Cuba certainly stands a chance, but it's going to be a difficult road for them ahead. You saw they lost that first match to Costa Rica 3-0. They had chances in that game, though. The thing is, they just could not finish them. It comes down to that. Can they create chances against the U.S., a backline that did not allow much against Belize, and can they actually finish them? If they can do that, they might be able to put a scare in Jurgen Klinsmann's hearts, but I think if you look back at these last two games for the U.S., 6 goals, I don't know that that continues, but I expect at least 3 out of this side and another win here in Group C.
Well, one U.S. men's national team player that we've been keeping a close watch on has been Stuart Holden. His return to the team, his first goal against Belize in 4 years in a U.S. men's national team jersey. He's made it no secret his desire to be a part of this senior roster. Does he have a chance, and what does he have to do to get there?
Well, I think he certainly has a chance. He's been with them in the most recent World Cup qualifiers. He's played in those games. Right now, he's just behind that twosome in the middle of the midfield, Michael Bradley and Jermaine Jones. I think he's got a long road ahead, but certainly anything can happen in the next year before Brazil. Michael Bradley could go down, Jermaine Jones could go down. Either of them could run into a difficult patch of form, and Stuart Holden, he is healthy now, he's motivated, he's going to get playing time with Bolton, and he brings a little bit something extra to this U.S. team. You've seen that he's the guy that comes on in the second half to really soften up a defense. He can play accurately long balls, he pushes forward, he can take the ball off the back of the defense. He is a versatile part, and I think if he stays healthy, there's no doubt he's in Brazil. It's just a matter of what role he plays.
Well, you can catch that U.S. versus Cuba game on Saturday, July 13th at 3:30 on Fox, and the second game, Costa Rica versus Belize, we haven't really touched on that yet. Quick thoughts.
Well, the thoughts are, it's a gulf in quality again for the Belizeans. Costa Rica clearly the better side. You would expect them to win and set up that showdown in the third match with the U.S., but it's the drama surrounding Belize that's really captured people's attention. Match-fixing allegations that have now been confirmed by CONCACAF, they'd identified the culprit. Can Belize get past those? Can they acquit themselves well? At this point, just trying to show a good face in this tournament.
Well, we can catch that game at 6 p.m. on Fox Soccer right after the U.S. versus Cuba game. And that's all we have for Gold Cup today. Andrew, thanks for joining me on this Friday.
Yep.
We'll be back on Monday with all of the weekend's action.